Hello everyone, I hope you are doing well. First thing first, next week's video will be the monthly Q&A. So please post your questions in the comment section or email me if you prefer to be anonymous. Well, now we also have a third option. Based on your feedback on last week's video, we have now set up a Discord server for DAO-E. The invite link is in the description. This is currently a public Discord, and anyone with a verified email address is welcome to join. In the Discord, we have created channels for each internal styles of martial art, Qigong, Xiudao, as well as TCM. You are welcome to engage in discussions, share your practice, make new friends, and do whatever else you like as long as you abide by the server rules. Once we enable registered memberships for DAO-E, there will most likely be a separate members-only offering on the Discord. I will announce it on the channel when we are ready. I believe Discord will serve the community well in terms of overall usability. But of course, we are always open to feedback from the community and can modify our approach based on the community's needs. I have to say that I only have a little bit of experience using Facebook and almost zero experience with Discord. But after spending a couple of hours of testing, I found it to be a great platform in terms of its user-friendliness, functionality, and many other useful features. I hope people in the community who opted for Facebook in last week's video comments will give our Discord a try. Also, we have activated the DAO-E Facebook page in order to announce some important events and necessary information. Please have a look as well. Of course, you are welcome to follow this page also. Furthermore, we have also added the DAO-E Charter on the website. As a non-profit organization, we will follow this charter to serve the community. Please have a look and let us know what you think. So, I welcome you all to join DAO-E's Discord and also follow DAO-E on Facebook. That was about it in terms of announcements. Let's get on with today's topic. People often ask me about the influence of the book Yi Jing on martial art practice. For example, Mr. Jonathan Bluestein had a conversation with me regarding Bagua practice last week. During our conversation, he asked a lot of questions about Bagua. I think it is worth talking about Yi Jing and its influence on internal martial art practice. Yi Jing is spelled Y-I-J-I-N-G and also commonly written as Yi Qing, spelled I-C-H-I-N-G. The English translation of the book title is the Book of Changes. Many people believe that in order to master the internal styles, especially Bagua, you have to understand this book at a deep level. Many people in the community believe that Bagua practice is closely related to Yi Jing. So, in this video, I will talk about Yi Jing and its relationships to the internal styles, especially Bagua, since Bagua Zhang is the style commonly perceived to have a close relationship with Yi Jing. After watching this video, you will not only have a better understanding of Yi Jing, but you will also understand Bagua Zhang practice on a deeper level. So, topics covered in today's video include: first, history of Yi Jing; second, connection between Bagua and Yi Jing; third, common misperceptions of Yi Jing and Bagua in practice; fourth, uniqueness of Bagua; fifth, how to practice Bagua according to Yi Jing; 6th, demonstration. 7th, correction of students' practice. And 8th, takeaways. Without any further ado, let's get started. First, history of Yi Jing. I have a video titled 八卦掌, Building Blocks, Requirements and Expectations. In that video, I briefly introduced this book. I'd like to just replay that part now. Before we talk about 八卦, the martial art, let's talk about 八卦, the philosophical concept. 八卦 the concept predates 八卦 the art by a few millennium. When studying the history of any internal martial art or meditation, we often come across important Chinese books that are claimed to either be the source of or heavily influence the style. In the case of 八卦, both the concept and the art, that book is Yi Jing, or the Book of Changes. Some of you may have tried to read this book. I guess about 80% of you may have only read 20% of the book. If that describes you, let me assure you, you are not to blame. The book itself is structured such that it is very hard to follow. I can assure you that more than 99.9% of Chinese people have not read the whole book. So it is worth taking a bit of time to introduce the Yi Jing before we talk about the main topic. Yi Jing, or the Book of Changes, is a Confucian classic. Originally, it was composed of three layers of document. In Yi Jing system, each trigram is composed of three lines, and each hexagram is composed of two trigrams or six lines. So the first layer is composed of the eight trigrams and 64 hexagrams. There's no historical evidence of its origin, the original author, but it is popularly attributed to Fu Xi, a mythical figure in the Chinese culture. Fu Xi is considered as one of the Chinese ancestors. The second layer of Yi Jing was written by King Wen and his son, the Duke of Zhou, during the 11th century BCE. The third layer incorporates seven pieces of writing composed from 5th to 2nd century BCE, divided into 10 segments. So people call it 10 wings. Many people believe this layer was written by Confucius himself, but at the same time, many scholars are against this claim. By 125 BCE, these three textual layers were combined to form what we now call the Yi Jing. It is worth noting that the 八卦created in the first layer is called Primordial 八卦, or 先天八卦 in Mandarin. And the 八卦created in the second layer is called Postmodal 八卦, or 后天八卦 in Mandarin. The Primordial 八卦 is mainly focused on the description of natural events, while the Postmodal 八卦 mainly focuses on the relations between humanity and nature, and the complexity of human life. Then, 10 winds section follows the same theme as the second layer. By the way, Yi Jing is also called Zhou Yi. The first layer of Yi Jing consisted of three books. However, two of them written before the Zhou Dynasty were lost, and only the book written in Zhou Dynasty survived. That's why people often call the entire book Zhou Yi. Another meaning of Zhou is circulation of changing, which coincidentally describe the nature of this book. Now, let's talk about the differences between the primordial and the postmodal Bagua concepts. To summarize, there are three differences here. First, the primordial Bagua was created by Fu Xi, the figurative ancestor of a Chinese people. The postmodal was created by Qin Wen and developed by his son. Qin Wen studied the primordial Bagua first and modified it to create postmodal Bagua later when he was in prison. Second point, different layout and representation of its directions. Many entities are present in both primordial and postmodal Bagua, but they often represent different things. In the primordial Bagua, Qian is the sky and represents south. But in postmodal Bagua, it represents northwest. In primordial Bagua, Kun is the earth and represents north. But in postmodal Bagua, it represents southwest. Third point. The primordial Bagua is mostly used to explain and predict the changes in nature phenomenon, while the postmodal Bagua is used to explain and predict human behavior changes and its consequences. Therefore, over many millennia, postmodal Bagua has especially gained cultural significance as a forecasting tool. I Ching is one of the oldest Chinese philosophical documents. Its underlying philosophy is the notion that the cosmos is in the process of constant change, without beginning or end. And it is the perpetual process that reflects three key characteristics, including continuity, wholeness, and dynamism. In the interest of time, I won't go into detail today, but I will focus on it sometimes in future. So, to summarize, I Ching is a philosophical book in Chinese history. But what is the relationship between this book to Bagua Zhang practice? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 2, I Ching and Bagua Zhang. In the same video that I mentioned in the last section, I briefly answered this question. Let's replay that part first, then I will explain it in much more details later. Bagua as a philosophical term and Bagua or Bagua Zhang as a martial art style. As mentioned in the previous topic, Bagua as a concept implies perpetual change. Bagua Zhang as a martial art style uses this very philosophy in its movements. And as a result, people use the same term, Bagua, to describe the style. In the beginning, Dong Haichuan and his disciple, at the most, only adapted the philosophical Bagua concept into the process of naming the eight Bagua Zhang palms and guiding their martial practice. Many people, including myself, really want to believe that Dong Haichuan and his direct disciples had the time and the wisdom to directly apply the Bagua 64 hexagrams into the martial art style. Unfortunately, the documents written by Dong Haichuan and Cheng Tinghua contains no evidence to provide that Either one of them had done it. So if someone claims that their 6 4 pawns can be traced back to directly to Dong Haichuan, they are lying to you. The first formally written document, which explained the application of the concept of Bagua to the martial art, was the book by Sun Lu Tang, published in 1917. Though it can be considered a further development, it still fell short of explaining concepts beyond the basic level. If we consider Dong Haichuan as the first generation, then the 6 4 palm was developed mostly by the third generation, not at all by Dong Haichuan or his direct disciples. The third generation of Bagua practitioners started using the primordial Bagua concept to get the body structure, basic palm change, circle walking, and other training method that focus on Bagua foundation. For example, the head is the qian or the sky trigrams, which need to be extended upward. The stomach is the kun or earth trigram, which needs to be solid and its energy should sink downward. The pulse module concept is used and adapted in training Bagua martial applications. I have learned different Cheng style 6 4 palms set and routines, including high posture, middle posture, and low posture forms, which were introduced in my Cheng style Bagua introduction video. Different Cheng style branches or sub styles have their own 6 4 movements or 6 4 palm or both. Basically, some Cheng style branches introduce their 6 4 movement system through a long routine, while other Cheng style branches introduce their 6 4 movement system through a set of single movements. Bear in mind that the term movement and the palm are used here mean two different concepts. A movement, also called hand, is a single isolated motion, while palm is a rather short but continuous set of movements guided by specific principles. By logical extension, the 6 4 movement system is different from the 6 4 palm system. The Cheng style branch I studied and have been practicing and teaching has the specific 6 4 palm system. Each palm is a small routine, some long, some short, focusing on a unique practice of this style. I will mainly focus on introducing this system in this video. To summarize, Yi Jing or the Book of Change can only provide some general guidance to Bagua practice. In other words, you do not have to master the Book of Yi Jing in order to practice Bagua, since there's no direct relationship between each specific hexagram to a specific Bagua movement. I will explain this reason in the following sections. Like I said in last week's video, clarifying some misperceptions sometimes can have a better result in disseminating knowledge. So, what are those commonly mistaken perceptions? That brings us to the next topic. Topic 3. Common misperceptions of Yi Jing and Bagua in practice. First, Bagua Zhang was created by Dong Haichuan. Well, this is the most popular assumption about the founder of Bagua Zhang. In particular, in the 1980s, Kang Gewu published a research paper titled Bagua Zhang Yuan Liu Zhi Yanjiu or research on source and course of Ba Guazhang at his martial art master degrees thesis. Among many titles, Kang is the martial art professor at the Beijing Support University, Secretary General of CWA or Chinese Wushu Association of China, the highest administrative body of Chinese martial art in China. He was one of the first martial art master degree graduates in China. By the way, in Professor Kang Gewu's article, through his research, he concluded that Dong Haichuan was likely the founder of Ba Guazhang. To translate his very own words, since his voice represents the official conclusion of that research, Dong Haichuan as a founder of Ba Guazhang has been widely accepted, even though Kang himself used the word likely in his work. However, many martial art experts, including myself, disagree with his research result, and with much historical evidence and new research, I can say with a fair degree of certainty that Dong Haichuan is not the founder of Ba Gua. Since this is a matter of historical research, let's talk about some evidence to support this conclusion. The first evidence is the script used for Dong Haichuan's epitaph. Around 1883, Dong Haichuan's students, including Yin Fu, Cheng Tinghua, and many others, built his cemetery in Beijing. His epitaph contains this quote: "Hou Yu Huang Guan Shou Yi Wu Shu, Sui Jing Quan Yong," end quote. Translation: later, he met a Taoist priest who taught him martial art, so that he became good at martial fighting. End translation. In the whole script, there are no words mentioning him as the founder of Ba Gua at all. In 1804, Yin Fu led his students to create another stone to memorialize Dong Haichuan. The script on this stone said, quote, "Gong Shen Li De Zi Tian Shou Er Ji Yi Yu Huo Zi Xian Chuan," end quote. Translation: his powerful strength is from the universe, and his techniques are from an immortal. End translation. In that script, Dong Haichuan's students Yin Fu praised Dong Haichuan's skill as taught by an immortal. What worth noting is that even in this instance, Dong Haichuan was not credited as the founder of Ba Gua. Around 1930, another stone built by many famous Ba Gua masters, including Ma Gui, Feng Junyi, and others, also did not contain any mention that Dong Haichuan created Ba Gua in the script. Now, let's look at Sun Lutang's writing about the founder of Ba Gua. Sun Lutang published his Ba Gua book around 1917, and in his book, he said, quote, "Ba Gua Quan Bu Zhi Chuang Yu He Shi He Ren, Wen You Dong Hai Chuan Xian Zheng Zhe, Jing Ji Ji Hao Ao You, Chang She Ji Jiang Wan Jian, Yu Yi Yi Ren, Chuan Yi Ci Ji." Translation: nobody knows when and who Ba Gua was created. Dong Haichuan, good at martial arts and enjoyed traveling, when he traveled to Jiang Wan regions, he met a person with extraordinary skill and taught him the practice. End translation. Bear in mind that all the names I mentioned just now, including Yin Fu, Cheng Tinghua, Ma Gui, Sun Lutang, and others, were either the direct students or grand students of Dong Haichuan. While these examples may not sufficiently disprove the claim given by the rampant phenomenon of cultural utopianism, there exists a lot of other evidence showing that Dong Haichuan was not the founder of Ba Guazhang, some of which I have already mentioned in my video on the introduction of Ba Guazhang and its key issues. Link is in the description. My informed and researched conclusion is that Dong Haichuan learned from a person who practiced 八卦掌, and that person may have learned 阴阳八盘掌, a style practiced in Wen'an, Hebei province, around 80 kilometers from Tianjin. I have a video titled八卦掌 Introduction and its Key Issues, Founder History Principles. In that video, I introduced 阴阳八盘掌, the possible root of modern 八卦掌 taught by Dong Haichuan. Link is in the description. To summarize, the assumption of Dong Haichuan as the founder of 八卦has been questioned more and more recently and as a historical issue. It may never get a conclusive answer. Considering all the evidence at hand, I'm quite comfortable in saying that Dong Haichuan was not the founder of 八卦. Second, 八卦掌 practice was created based on circle walking. Well, this is another common misperception. In the 八卦掌 training manuals, which contains the teachings of Dong Haichuan, authored by Dong Haichuan's students, for example, the 36 training poems written by Quan Kaiting, there is not a single mention of the term circle walking. In other words, circle walking is a much newer term used in the description of 八卦掌 training. In the same 八卦introduction video, I also introduced the history of 八卦 circle walking. Cheng Tinghua, a disciple of Dong Haichuan, who had trained in Shuai Jiao or Chinese wrestling, created this type of walking pattern as a main practice. Dong Haichuan's teaching only mentioned circular pattern stepping in a couple of places in the 36th training poems document, but not circle walking at all. And let me remind you, circle walking is not to be confused with circular pattern stepping. Furthermore, in 阴阳八盘掌, which I believe to be the procedure style that Dong Haichuan practiced before teaching the new version of 八卦 in Beijing, there are 8 types of walking patterns, and circle walking is only one of them. As mentioned in the book title, 阴阳八盘掌, published in 1937. To the best of my knowledge, circle walking in 阴阳八盘掌 is only a small part of its practice and looks nowhere the same as Cheng style 八卦掌's circle walking. So to summarize, circle walking is a later invention by Dong Haichuan's students, Cheng Tinghua, and not by Dong Haichuan himself. There were many more walking patterns in 阴阳八盘掌 originally. Unfortunately, most of the 八卦 practice right now mainly focused on the circle walking instead of other patterns simultaneously. Third, 八卦掌 was created based on 转天尊. Professor Kang Gewu claimed that Dong Haichuan studied 转天尊 and then developed 八卦 practice based on that. Well, this is another false claim. So first, let's talk about 转天尊. It is a Taoist religious ritual developed by Qiu Shuji, who lived from 1148 to 1227 CE. The founder of Quan Zhen Long Men Pai or Total Reality Dragon Gate sect of Taoism. It was a religious ritual, and even today, many Taoist temples still practice it. I found a small video clip of it. Let's look at it first. Thank you. Do you think Dong Haichuan could develop Ba Guazhang based on this? And is there any evidence that Dong Haichuan studied this religious practice? None at all. Sure, evidently there exists some circle walking practice in religious Taoism, but in no way does it indicate any relationship with Ba Gua. In the old time of China, people in the countryside used animals to push the stone grill so that wheat could be processed into flour. Normally, a donkey was the best animal for this task. Then, why doesn't anyone claim that Dong Haichuan learned Ba Gua walking from a donkey? Well, the idea of learning from a donkey is not as appealing and attractive as learning from a Taoist priest walking in a circle while chanting a religious hymn. 4. Ba Guazhang can be practiced as a meditation. This is another commonly mistaken claim. Yes, any movement can be practiced in a meditative way. But a meditative way of doing certain things without satisfying the basic criteria of a traditional meditation is not meditation. In other words, being meditative alone is not meditation. When you walk in a circle such as while practicing Ba Gua, even though you can treat it in a meditative way, it is still a martial art movement. Martial art movements are not meditation and should never be considered as such. At most, you could consider it to be a form of casual qigong practice. In other words, it is simply wrong to practice Ba Gua meditatively. Not only could you not achieve the martial benefit, but more importantly, if your intention is to practice meditation, Ba Gua walking in a meditative state would not provide any of the benefit of meditation. Specific benefits need specific training method. 5th, there are 8 trigrams in Yi Jing. So in Ba Gua circle walking, you have to focus on all 8 trigrams. Well, this claim is also totally wrong. I have explained that Yi Jing is part of Chinese culture and ancient Chinese people used it to explain different phenomena in the universe. It has the same history, function, and tradition as other concepts such as Yin Yang and 5 elements. Yes, there are 8 directions which can be explained and indicated by the Ba Gua concept in Yi Jing. However, in Ba Gua as a martial art practice, it is not necessary to have 8 steps for each circle walking. In other words, you can walk as many steps as you like in a Ba Gua circle walking exercise. If you really force yourself to complete a circle walking with 8 steps, that is a mistake. Circle walking should be natural. There are many other misperceptions about Ba Gua, which I will talk about in the future. For now, let's move on to the next topic. Topic 4. Uniqueness of Ba Guazhang. After clarifying some common misperceptions, let's talk about the unique characteristics of Ba Gua. In other words, we should answer the question, what made Ba Gua so popular back in Dong Haichuan's time? My extensive research has led me to conclude the following 2 aspects about the uniqueness of Ba Gua. First, Ba Gua was distinctively different from other martial art styles of the time in terms of training method. Traditionally, Chinese martial art training really emphasizes the concept of stability. Stance training and maintaining a strong structure in any movement is one of the criteria of any Chinese style. However, when Ba Gua was introduced to Beijing by Dong Haichuan, it really emphasized the concept of a dynamic approach. All of the techniques are applied in a much more dynamic state, or in a walking state. Of course, all of the other Chinese martial arts styles apply a dynamic approach as well, but none of the other styles emphasize the importance of walking as much as Bagua. It was a brand new approach back then. This was one of the reasons why Bagua Zhang became very popular, and most of Donghai Chuan students were already some famous fighters prior to practicing with him. Very often, a good practitioner always looks for a new training system to improve his or her skill. Second, Bagua training applies palm strike more than any other Chinese style. Again, palm is softer than the fist as a disadvantage. However, palm can be flexible and can be used to strike a certain area more effectively than the fist. For instance, palm is more suitable to strike on a hard surface such as the chest. Furthermore, Bagua places a heavy emphasis on shenfa, or flexible body method, in order to take advantage of palm strikes. The body method needs to be adjusted accordingly to apply a strong but flexible palm strike. This is why Bagua practice requires a specific body method. This Bagua body method makes Bagua very unique. I will elaborate on Bagua's shenfa in the future. Simply speaking, Bagua's circle walking and circular pattern stepping makes the Bagua body method possible. Without Bagua walking, the Bagua strike will not be as powerful and flexible as it exists today. So, understanding this topic should help you focus on the main practice, which is the curriculum of Bagua Zhang, not the Yi Jing book. Topic 5. How to practice Bagua Zhang according to Yi Jing. I have mentioned that the Bagua or 8 trigrams in Yi Jing book can be applied to Bagua practice to guide the body structure. Now, I'd like to introduce some new topics about it. First, 8 trigrams can be used to describe 8 types of forces used in Bagua practice, including Tui, Tuo, Dai, Luo, Ban, Kou, Pi, Jin. By the way, there are different versions of the 8 type of Bagua forces. Also, 8 trigrams can be used to describe 8 type of hand movements, 8 type of kickings, 8 big palms, and so on. Be very careful here. The spirit of Yi Jing is not only Bagua or 8 trigrams. More importantly, it is yin and yang. To quote the Yi Jing, Yi yin yi yang zhi wei dao. Translation, Dao contains one yin and one yang. Or, the yin and the yang make up the Dao. This is one of the most important concepts of the spirit of the Yi Jing, the Book of Changes. So, focusing on yin and yang in practice is the real spirit of Bagua practice according to the concept of Yi Jing. Second, you have to know that in all of the Chinese martial art styles, Zheng, which means coordination or unification, is the key concept. So, you can emphasize different types of forces or techniques in training. But at the end of the day, all of the focuses and the techniques should be unified and coordinated at an advanced level. In other words, at an advanced level of Bagua practice, all those 8 types of forces should exist in each movement. Overemphasizing the characteristics of each trigram in practice is not the right approach. We should not confuse the terms used to describe a practice to the practice itself. A term cannot replace a practice, and the practice is the only true test of the correct understanding of a term. So, in practice, you should focus on the zheng, or coordination and unification, not each single trigram, which is just a term used to describe a name and its nature in practice. 3. Last but not least, let's talk about the 64 palms. I have briefly mentioned the 64 palm system in prior videos. Also, it's worth noting that different versions of a 64 palm exist today. For example, some schools only practice a long routine and the routine contains of 64 palms or 64 techniques. Some other schools practice the 64 palms in 64 separate short sets, and each set represents a focused technique. Personally, I prefer the second approach. I studied different sets of 64 palms when I was a child. Over the last 10 plus years, I have been working on organizing and restructuring these 64 technique sets in order to make it more complete. Basically, there are 8 big palms, and then for each gua or trigram, there are 7 small sets totaling 64 palms. The 8 trigrams can be further extended in to form 64 hexagrams. What I'm working on is to assign each hexagram to each of the 64 sets, and make sure each palm will reflect the nature of each hexagram. I have been working on it for years, and I hope to publish it in the future. It will be my original contribution to the Bagua. Topic 6. Demonstration. Today, I'd like to demonstrate a Cheng-style Bagua exercise. It is used to improve the Bagua body method. Okay, one Bagua exercise from the Cheng-style to practice continuity and flexibility. You can start from the Bagua posture, then extend chest, then wait, then turn. Let me repeat again. So, the first step, move inward, then extend the chest, then outward, then step. Topic 7, correction of a student's practice. In today's video, I will correct my student's Bagua practice. It is one of the 64 palms. Okay. Now, let my students to demonstrate the Cheng style Bagua palm, the third one. Then I correct his movement. Slowly. Yeah, he can walk toward this direction. Yes. Yes. Right. Then turn. Okay. So close. Pretty good, but there's still space to improve. Okay, let me correct his movement. And from beginning, it's not bad, not bad. First of all, the beginning form, have one palm up, body turn a little bit, and down, straight, then turn again, yes. Okay, stop at here. First of all, knee pushed forward, weight back, relax a little bit, yes. Then the index finger point upward, relax a little bit. Then continue slowly. 1, 2. Then, yes. Again. 3, 4. Good. 5. Then, from here now. So let's come back to here, okay? And when you turn, then the first move, at the same time, both the palm rotate. 1, and elbow extend outward. Yes, then right elbow in, then 2, then 3. Now move back, So again, then three. One, then two, stop. Then three. Yes. Then continue. Four. Do not look back. Four, just a little bit. Then still look at here. Then extend body, sink down. One, then up, then step. One more thing at here, this movement. The first point at here, this place. So one, then two, three. This place. One, right, and the palm open a little bit, back palm. Elbow point forward, do not, yes. Then in, elbow in first, then palm rotate. Right, then solid posture, three. Then body sink down, right. Then close. Very good, thank you. Topic 8, takeaways. First, history of Yi Jing. Yi Jing is one of the oldest Chinese philosophical documents. Its underlying philosophy is the notion that the cosmos is in the process of constant change without beginning or end. And it is the perpetual process that reflects the three key characteristics, including continuity, wholeness, and dynamism. Second, connection between Ba Gua Zhang and Yi Jing. Yi Jing, or the Book of Change, can only provide some general guidance to Ba Gua practice. In other words, you do not have to master the Book of Yi Jing in order to practice Ba Gua, since there is no direct relationship between each specific hexagram to a specific Ba Gua movements. 3. Common misperceptions of Yi Jing and Ba Gua in practice. First, Ba Gua Zhang was created by Dong Haichuan. Second, Ba Gua Zhang practice was created based on circle walking. Third, Ba Gua Zhang was created based on Zhuan Tianzun. Fourth, Ba Gua Zhang can be practiced as meditation. Fifth, there are 8 trigrams in Yi Jing, so in Ba Gua circle walking, you have to focus on all 8 trigrams. Topic 4. Uniqueness of Ba Gua Zhang. First, dynamic approach in martial art practice was first emphasized by Ba Gua compared to other Chinese styles back then. Second, palm strike requires specific body method or shen fa. Topic 5. How to practice Ba Gua Zhang according to Yi Jing. First, focus on yin yang. Second, focus on zheng, or coordination and unification. I will publish my research result about the 6-4 palms with 6-4 hexagrams in the future. Please remember to check out the demonstration and the student correction sections to get a better idea about the Ba Gua practice. A quick reminder to send me your questions for the next week's Q&A video. So, that brings us to the end of today's video. Thank you for watching, see you next time, and enjoy your practice.